Hello, my name is John Fisher, and this is Mochesta. Years ago, I had a show that ran for a year and a half in downtown San Francisco. In 9 months of that run, I was in the Stage Door Theater, and this theater was great. It was the most beautiful theaters from the 1920s, this theater. It was magnificent. And every night, I made my entrance from the audience. I had to come out of the balcony, cross up, and then go on the stage. And the balcony was beautiful because it wrapped around the downstairs auditorium. And lining the balcony above the seats of the audience were these wonderful, what I call cameos. There were these incredible pictures, circular in shape, about this big, of all of San Francisco's great 19th century stage artists. They were magnificent. There were 12 of them. And above stage left, on my right side, as I entered, was a picture of my favorite, David Belasco, that great writer, director, producer, star. And he wore that beautiful white priest's collar. Now, he wasn't a priest, but he thought of the theater as priestly. He thought of it as a devotional space, so he dressed like a priest. I loved it. And on the other side of the stage, stage right, my left, above the seats, was a woman I didn't know. And when we moved into the theater, while the set was being built, I went over there and I looked up to see what she was. And her name was Mochesta. And she looked so elegant and spectacular. Now, these things were like stained glass and were backlit, so they looked like gods smiling down upon us. And I learned all about Mochesta that summer. I got a book out from the San Francisco Public Library, her memoirs. They only had one copy, and it's old. It's like an original edition. And I pored over this book, and I discovered that she came from Poland, from Warsaw and Krakow. And she came here to conquer the San Francisco stages and then the rest of the country. And it was a wonderful story. And what I loved most about this story was, what I thought was so incredible about it, I just loved it. This story was great. She acted on stage from the mid-1870s in San Francisco all the way into the 19th century. She kept acting until she was 67, and she never dropped any roles from her repertory. And what I loved about it was one of her roles was Juliet, who was 14 years old, and she played a 14-year-old at 67. I thought that was great. A 14-year-old at 67, with that luscious accent that she never lost. Mochesta, the star of Poland. My bounty is as boundless as the sea. My love is deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite. I was obsessed with Mochesta that summer, and remain obsessed with her always. So here we go with the story of Helena Mochesta, star of Poland and the United States. I was born in Krakow in 1840. I was always shy. There were 10 children in my family, so I was very meek and mild, but my brothers and sisters protected me. Krakow at that time was a free city. Poland had been a great nation in the Middle Ages, but it was divided up. But Napoleon arrived at the beginning of the 19th century, and he brought Poland back together again. But when Napoleon was crushed in 1815, the Congress of Vienna met and they divided up Poland once again amongst the victors. The East went to Russia, the West went to Prussia, and the South went to Austria. Only Krakow was left a free city. It was the only free city in Poland, declared free by the Congress of Vienna. In 1846, I was only 6 years old, but it was my first memory of gunshots heard outside the window of our kitchen. My brothers and I hid from the gunshots. It was an insurrection. The people of Krakow had risen up against the Austrians, the Prussians, and the Russians. They were going to unify Poland once again. They were going to bring Poland back to the great days of the Middle Ages when it was one nation.
people so afraid of Title 46. Soon there was quiet, because the Austrians had invaded the free city of Krakow, and they had arrested all of the insurrectionists. But then a very weird, strange thing happened. Every night, my aunt would go to the window, and she would sing a song. I didn't understand the song, but I would learn it later. She asked me to join in with her. And then she would do something very strange. She would signal with her hand out the window. I never knew what it was, and one night I asked her. And she said across the alley was the prison, where the Austrians put the political prisoners, the Poles of Krakow, who had risen up against them. They were imprisoned across the alley. And my aunt, my wonderful aunt, would signal to them, and they would signal back. And she would pass messages along to their families to tell them that they were okay. The Austrians held the insurrectionists for months, and then they officially annexed Krakow to Austria. The 3 days of Krakow were over. Sadness fell upon the last free part of Poland. It would never be free so long as I lived. Political prisoners next door, eventually they would be released. But I had been born into the sadness of Poland. Poland always divided. My brother Felix was an actor, and he knew that I loved to show off. So when I was a teenager, he arranged an audition for me. I was 14. And I went to see a great actress who was a wonderful acting teacher. She gave me a speech to memorize. I was to bring it back the next day and perform it for her. And the next day I walked in, and I was so nervous, but I launched into the speech, "Blow, wind, and crack your cheeks. Rage, blow, you cataracts and hurricanoes. Spout, till you are drenched, our steeples drown the cocks." She told my mother that I was a terrible actress. I had giggled through the entire speech. It was a disastrous first lesson. My mother did not care, because she thought that all actresses were prostitutes, so she did not want me to go on the stage after all. But she made a big mistake, because very soon after that, she took me to a production of Shakespeare's masterpiece, Hamlet. It starred Fritz Devrient, and he was magnificent. And I learned all the lessons that I was not able to learn from that awful older woman. I learned the lessons of acting from Hamlet himself. As you know, in the play, Hamlet writes a play, The Mousetrap, which is meant to unveil his uncle as the villain. And he hires players to play his play, but they must play it authentically, or they will not scare the king, the uncle, the evil uncle, into admitting that he has murdered Hamlet's father. So Hamlet has had a wonderful speech to the actors, encouraging them to be honest in their roles. "Speak the speech, I pray you, as I pronounced it to you trippingly on the tongue. For if you mouth it, as many of your players shall do, I had as lief the tongue cry, spoke my lines. Nor do not saw the air too much with your hands thus, but use all gently. From the very torrent, tempest, and then they say, whirlwind of your passion, you must acquire and beget a temperance that will give it smoothness." Oh, it offends me to the very soul to see a robustious, perilly painted fellow tear a passion to tatters, to bury rags, to spit the ears of the groundlings, who, for the most part, are capable of nothing but inexplicable dumb shows and noise. I would have such a fellow whipped for ordering termagant without Herod's Herod. Pray you avoid it. Fritz Devrient, he taught me everything in Hamlet's monologue about the honesty I must find on the stage. In 1861, I met a wonderful man, Modjeski. He taught me so much. He was 20 years my senior, but we were a magnificent couple. He encouraged me, and I married him, and he made me very happy. My son was born Rudolf, and Modjeski decided that we must leave Krakow. It was too dangerous. There was too much political strife. He did not feel safe there, so he took me to Buknia, the mining country. But Buknia has just suffered a horrible tragedy. The mines have collapsed. Hundreds of Buknian miners have been killed. And my husband, he had the wonderful idea he would put on a benefit for these people, for the families of the lost miners. He would raise money. He would put on a performance. And I, now calling myself Jessica, would be the star of the production. We rehearsed for 2 weeks. 2 weeks. But I was terrified. I was backstage. I could not remember my lines. I was fighting. I could not go on stage. I was so nervous. I knew my lines perfectly. But just before the curtain went up, I could not remember them. I was cowering backstage, hiding in my dress. And my husband came to me to get on the stage. I said, I can't. And he thrust me onto the stage behind the curtain. And then I heard the audience through the curtain, and then the curtain shot up. The lights fell on me, and I gave a magnificent performance. Perfect. Once I was on the way, I was fine. It was crossing that threshold of art that made me so nervous. The production was such a success that we revived it 3 more times to raise more money for all the miners' survivors. And then my husband said we must keep going. We have this wonderful company of local actors and myself. We must do another production. We can't do that one over and over again. But you, Modjeska, must find some variety in your acting. So he cast me as a man. And by then, I had become enamored of putting on makeup and disguising myself. And I knew that I could be a man. I knew that it would not be that difficult. So I gave myself a mustache. And that night, I was told a man from the Imperial Theater in Warsaw, the old capital of Poland, was in the house. And I went on stage with my big chest and my deep voice, and I played this big, strapping man in this production, completely different from the character I had played the night before. I put my hands in my belt, I spat, and I talked like this. And afterwards, the man from the Imperial Theater in Warsaw came backstage, and he said, "You must come to Warsaw and act with us." And from that moment, I knew that I must be an actress or die. My husband said that we would go on tour. That is how we would make money. We would keep this wonderful company of actors together, and we would go on tour. We would tour the provinces, and I would play all the leading roles. It was a dream come true. And what I loved most about the tour was we went to many small towns. And in Poland then, the towns were always separated. The Jewish people lived in the shtetl, that half of town, and the Gentiles lived in the other half, and they very rarely mingled, especially socially. But when the play came to town, when we arrived in our covered wagon, like we were in the Wild West, trundling into town and set up our show, and were ready to perform, the theater filled with Jewish people and with Gentiles. All of them coming together like a community. This was Poland at its best, at its strongest. Now, my husband gave me many roles to learn, but I would only play roles that I felt were in me. I had to see myself inside the role, or the role inside me. I could not just play anything. I had to know that it was the right role for me. I could play men. I had variety. I had breath, but I had to know the role in me, in my soul, speak the speech I played, as I pronounced it to you. I had to believe you. In 1861, it was a very sad time for Warsaw and for Poland. The Russian nobles did not want to let the serfs be emancipated yet, but the Polish nobles did. In Warsaw, they were determined to emancipate the serfs. They were inspired by the Americans, who were fighting a civil war, whereby the North would free the slaves. The Polish nobles wanted to emancipate their serfs, but the Tsar, who held sway over Warsaw and that part of Poland, said no. We would not let the serfs be set free. And so there was an insurrection amongst the nobles of Warsaw, and the fighting started. The fighting over this issue of freedom. We toured constantly in our covered wagons all across Poland. At first, I was happy, I was gay, I was excited to arrive in new towns, to bring the communities together, but I got more and more tired, and I was always the star, and my husband would not let one of the other actresses play the roles as we toured in our covered wagon, because he said, they are coming to see you, they are coming to see you. But this time, I became pregnant with my daughter, and I was exhausted. One day, after performing a five-act drama, 2 hours after the curtain rang down, I gave birth to my daughter, Marita. I barely had strength to pick her up and hold her. My husband, Modjeski, gave me 10 days to nurse that child. And then it was back on stage, playing the leads, back in the covered wagon, and very little time with my daughter. My son, Rudolf, had already been sent back to Krakow. I never saw him. He lived with my mother because I could not raise him. There was no time. In 1863, the Polish uprising was ruthlessly suppressed by the Russians. It was a sad time for the Poland. I was hired by the theater in Lemberg to play Lady Teazle in that wonderful British comedy, The School for Scandal. If you wanted authority over me, you should have adopted me, not married me. I thought a lot about what Lady Teazle said to her husband. I also wanted to play the great tragic roles, but my voice was too high. So I was determined to bring my voice down so I could play those great Shakespearean tragedian roles. I had to bring my voice down, down. In 1865, my daughter Marilka died. I think it was too rough for a little baby to live in those circumstances. I also left my husband that year. I had found out that Modjeski was still married to his first wife. Our marriage was invalid. He was not my husband, he never had been. I got my son Rudolf and we left Modjeski. We left him on the tour in his covered wagon. Fortunately, I had been signed by the Krakow Theater. They asked me what my first role would be, and I said, well, it must be Hamlet, and I will play Ophelia. And I was determined to have that Shakespearean voice to bring my high-pitched voice down, 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 so I could be a Shakespearean. And at the first rehearsal, I was playing my big scene with Hamlet. He was acting crazy, he was acting insane. And I said, oh, heavenly powers, restore him. Down, down, down. Oh, what a noble mind is here, o'erthrown. The producer of the theater very politely said to me, Madame Modjeska, that voice is not the voice of Ophelia, because Ophelia is a 14. You are making Ophelia sound like an ogre, like a monster, like a very old, mean man. Please, make her sound like a teenager. One night, I was in the repertory, and I was playing a small role, and I did something very unprofessional, because when you play a small role in repertory, you have to stand on stage for long periods of time. And I was standing there, and I had no lines, and I looked out at the audience, something I never did. And up in the balcony, I saw him. He was leaning over the balcony there, staring at me on stage with a smirk, a sarcastic smirk on his face. He was so handsome and so clever looking. After the performance, he came backstage and introduced himself. He was Charles Jabrowski. Jabrowski had come backstage to meet me. He had been in the introduction, but not in the Russian or Austrian portions, but in the Prussian portion, in the city of Posen. He was captured by the Prussians, and he had served a 20-month sentence in the prison of Mohabit in Berlin. His family was noble, a noble family, and he was magnificent. His grandfather had been a general in Napoleon's army. He was a great man. And I was so interested in him. He used to come over to my home and kill me. And of course, I was living with my brother at the time and his wife and his children, and we had to be very quiet when we were talking about love, because anybody could walk in the room at any time. And the Chopalsky and I would be very quiet. And I had an inspiration, because I wanted for the next role to be Romeo and Juliet, and I had an inspiration about the balcony scene. It taught me that the balcony scene should be played in whispers. Usually, the balcony scene was played like this: Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou Romeo? But I realized that no, this was Juliet's family's house, and if she was found there with Romeo, her family would kill both of them, so they had to be quiet. So every night, Romeo and I play the scene quietly, like this. Romeo! And as we got quiet, the audience got quieter, and then we got quieter, and the audience got quieter, and the audience pretended that somebody could come on at any minute and catch us in our lovemaking. And we got so quiet, and the audience got so quiet, that it was silent in that theater. By the end of the scene, there was almost no sound on stage or in the auditorium. And I said to Romeo, "Good night." Such a sweet sorrow that I should say. I had learned what love was, authentic love, and it helped me play the scene. In 1868, I was married to Chopalsky. I was so happy. And also that year, I was engaged to the Warsaw Imperial Theatre. I was headed to the capital, the most important city in Poland. They asked me what I would play for my premiere, and I chose that wonderful play by Scribe, Adrian Vukovar. I would play Adrian. And on my opening night, I was so nervous that I missed my entrance. My cue was that the character on stage would say, Madame Adrienne is not rehearsing with Monsieur Querelle. How strange. And I was supposed to enter as if I was rehearsing my scene, reading my lines. On the cue, how strange. The opening night, I heard my cue, Madame Adrienne is rehearsing without Monsieur Querelle. How strange. And I couldn't move. And the actor on stage repeated the line, Madame Adrienne is rehearsing without Monsieur Querelle. How strange. I was terrified. I could not move. And the actor crossed to the wing right next to me. He was on stage, I was off, and he said, Madame Adrienne is rehearsing without Monsieur Querelle. How strange. Get off stage. And one of the stagehands grabbed me and pushed me on stage. And there I was in front of the audience, and I opened my prop script and I said, "Leave me! The palace gates must be closed at once." No, no, that's not right. "Leave me! The palace gates must be closed at once." And I was magnificent as Adrian. Once I got on stage, I had overcome my nerves. I had made my entrance, but there was a new problem to deal with. Trupowski, my husband, my handsome, clever husband, had become editor of a nationalist paper, The Country, it was called. Now, this was not a revolutionary paper. This was a paper that was peacefully calling for the reunification of Poland. Not through revolution or insurrection, but through cooperation, through politics, through negotiation. Unfortunately, the Russians did not agree with this, and we were spied upon. They thought we were insurrectionists. The police followed him everywhere. Meanwhile, the Russian censor would not let me perform Hamlet. I could not do my Ophelia in Warsaw because the Russian censor said, "No, you cannot perform that obscene play." I said, "Why obscene?" He said, "Because it's about the murder of a king. People will think that you are espousing the murder of the Tsar, of Alexander II. We cannot have that." I said, "It is not a play about the murder of the king." He said, "Yes, it is. They kill the king. They kill the king." I said, "No, no, it's a family drama. It is. It's everybody hates their father. Everybody wants to kill their father. It's just a family drama. It's a domestic drama. It's not a tragedy. Don't think of it that way. It's just a light-hearted drama." He was not persuaded. But then we found out that he had a little friend, the censor had a little friend in the ballet, and the little friend wanted to become an actress. And we went to him and we said, "Would your little friend like to leave the ballet and become an actress at the Imperial Theatre of Warsaw?" He said, "Yes, of course." She would, and she joined our company, and suddenly the censor had no problem with us performing Hamlet. Now, I was allowed to choose my own plays, and the next play I wanted to do, of course, was Romeo and Juliet, but immediately a problem with the censor. The censor said, "No, no, no, this is a traditional country, a Christian country. You can't have young people making love in the dark. No, 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 they're not married. You can do Romeo and Juliet, but you have to cut the balcony scene." Cut the balcony scene? Can you imagine performing Romeo and Juliet without the balcony scene? It is absurd. But I remembered asking, "Do you have a little friend, another little friend at the ballet?" He said, "Oh yes, I do, as a matter of fact. How did you guess?" I said, "Oh, I don't know. Is she interested in becoming an actress?" And he said, "Yes, she is." So we got another ballet actress friend in our company, and the ban on Romeo and Juliet was lifted. We held soirees, my husband and I, for all our friends, our artist friends, painters, sculptors, writers, poets, but they all had liberal leanings, so we were watched by the police. We never talked about politics, we talked about art, creativity, imagination. But they thought we were planning an insurrection, so we were always watched. I contracted typhoid, but I had to go on. Every night I had to go on and give my performances. Once I was in front of the audience, I was fine, but the rest of the day I could barely make it down to the theater. And even when I recovered, my hair fell out. I had to wear wigs. The wigs used to pop off on stage. It was not a happy time for me, but when I was in front of the audience, they loved my performances. So I was giving energy. Unfortunately, my peers at the theater, the other actresses, the actors, the people I worked with were all jealous of me. They were jealous of my opportunities, my sway over the audience, my popularity. I said, "I worked for this. It isn't just given to me. I worked for this." Very few of them talked to me. It became a drive just to go to the theater. I hated going to work, to do the profession I loved. once I was on the stage, I was fine. Afterwards, and before, I felt only jealousy and rage. The censorship continued, every play a struggle. The police watching our house, life in Warsaw was almost intolerable. In 1875, we held a party for our closest friends. Not big, we wouldn't want to attract the police. And a wonderful writer, Shenkevich, would one day write that marvelous book, Quo Vadis, about St. Paul and the evil Emperor Nero, came to the party and he said, there is a promised land. It is in America out west. It is called Anaheim. It is in California. In Anaheim, you can get an orange orchard for nothing. You can raise cattle. You can grow wine grapes, muscat. You can raise chickens and eat their eggs. It takes very little effort to grow things there. And an orange is a magnificent thing. A piece of magic. The sun shines every day. It only rains enough to grow the oranges. We could go there, all of us. We could live as a commune. We could do all the work ourselves in the morning, and we would have the entire afternoon to create. We wouldn't have to work so hard. And there's no government. There's no government. There's nobody to tell us we can't write this or say that. There is no censor. It would be magnificent. Like an artist's colony in the new world. What do you think? I could not go. I had to perform. I had a duty to the audience. My son came home from school, his boarding school. He was depressed. He wanted to be an engineer, to build bridges, but he knew already that never would a Pole be allowed to build bridges in Poland. He told me that he had heard of a wonderful exposition in Philadelphia, a world exposition. He wanted to go to Philadelphia to see the exposition, to see the engineering exhibits. He asked me, is there any possibility that we could travel to Philadelphia? Oh. Meanwhile, I was exhausted, but I kept having to go on stage. And every day, backstage, the jealousy, the rage, the comments, the silences. But when I was on stage, I was majestic. I would trudge home, feeling the weight of the smallness of the people I worked with. And one night, my husband had an idea. He'd been reading about Brook Farm in Massachusetts in the writing of Nathaniel Hawthorne. He said, We could go to the promised land of Anaheim. Just us, the artists, with your son, we could see the Philadelphia Exposition. We could grow in the afternoons and evenings. We could create. We could escape. We could escape the tensions of Poland. So many had gone before us. I was so tired. I said, yes. I went to the director of the theater. I said, I am leaving the theater. He said, you'll be back. You will not stay in America. I said, yes, I will stay. He said, you can have a year. Go do what you need to for a year, but you will be back. So my husband and I left with only Ralph, my son. We traveled to Bremen, and then we took a Prussian steamer across the Atlantic to the United States. It was a magnificent journey. I adored being at sea. The ship rocked and rocked and rocked, and many thought it would sink, and it rolled with the waves, almost a storm the whole way, and people stayed below deck. They were so frightened, but I was enraptured. I stayed on deck and watched the ocean because I saw God's majesty in the water, and I realized we would never sink because we were on the water, and no matter what the waves did, God considered us part of his majesty, and we would go down into the troughs and on top of the swells, and the ship was outrageous in the storm, and when we were in the trough, I would see a wave soaring above me, and it would crest, and the foam would catch the moonlight, and it would become iridescent, incandescent, blown with light, soaring above me like a cloud, as if I was in heaven itself. It was a magical journey to the United States, and when we arrived in New York City, that too was a magical place. It was so big, it was gigantic, but it was a bazaar. Everything, all the time. The buildings were huge, but they were not attractive. They were great, brick buildings. They did not have beautiful marble buildings like in Europe, like in Warsaw, in Krakow. It was a confusing, exciting theater, but soon we were on another ship. We were headed to Panama. We crossed Panama and got another ship up the west coast. Past Mexico, we were headed to San Francisco. And I was so excited to see that city, to see the Golden Gate. But as we approached the Golden Gate, I saw that it was smothered in fog. I could see nothing of the Golden Gate. All I saw was fog everywhere. It was like entering through whipped cream. I saw nothing. But many Polish expatriates met us at the pier, and they were wonderful. And that first night, they took me to the big theater in San Francisco, the California Theater, and we saw the wonderful American actor Edwin Booth play Shylock. I'm a Jew? I thought, a Jew eyes? And the next night, even more spectacular, we saw him play Mark Antony in Julius Caesar. Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him. The evil that men do lives after them. The good is oft interred in their bones. So let it be with Caesar. He was phenomenal. There was something godlike in his performances. And my friend said we will talk to him. We will ask him to revive Hamlet. He will be Hamlet and you will be Ophelia. But he told them he was not interested in all the extra rehearsals. And I realized that in America, nobody knew about Modjeska. And I brought no notices because I never read criticism. So I would have to start from scratch if I wanted to act. But we had come here to Palm, so we boarded another ship a few weeks later, and we sailed south to Anaheim Landing. We went ashore in Anaheim, and we took a carriage to the house we had bought, and there it was, and soaring up above it were the Santa Ana Mountains, so majestic right there. I never lived so close to nature. It was stunning. And between the Santa Ana Mountains and my house was the farm. Orange trees, cows. The house was too small. It was very cramped and too small, but it didn't matter. We had a porch and we could sit out there, and the world was our house. And every day the men went out to work in the farm. It was very, very hard work. We knew nothing about farming. We were artists, but we were learning. And the women did the housework, and I cooked for the men, and I was not a good cook. I burnt everything, but there was a reason that I burnt everything, because I wanted the food to be safe. I wanted it to be cooked, and I never knew whether or not it was cooked until it was burnt. Fortunately, the men were always hungry, and I realized that the best ingredient for my cooking, for any recipe of mine, was hunger. They gobbled the food, and always said it was wonderful. Who was I to deny it? The work on the farm did not go well. The other men became lazy. My husband, Chapalsky, and my son, Rudolf, continued to work every day. The other men wrote, composed, did their artistic things. My husband, my son, worked a little. We decided that we needed a vacation, so we went to Anaheim Landing on our horses. I loved my wild horse and petted the whole way. It bit me, but that feels all right. I loved that horse that I did. When we got to Anaheim Landing, I walked out on the beach and I saw that huge ocean, and I was reminded of the magical Atlantic that we crossed. And on the other side of it, Warsaw, Krakow, Poland by Poland. And all I could feel was regret for what I had given up. The theater, the audiences, all those wonderful roles. I did not think of the jealousy, the rage, the police, the censorship. I only missed what I had loved so much about being on stage and being in my homeland. I lay on the sand and I wept many bitter tears for all I had given up to come to this new world. We returned to our farm, but the farm was not good. It was November of 1876, and the Santa Ana winds came thundering out of the mountains. They were hot like a scirocco. They melted us. They enervated us. We were depressed. We were failing. We had not succeeded. The oranges would not grow. We did not know how to milk the cows. The neighbors came and stole the muscat grapes. We said, you cannot steal our grapes. They said, we have taken these grapes for years, and we were too courteous to tell them that they could not take them. The cows began to eat the barley. My husband gave me a gun, and I fired it over the cows' heads. They did not, and they did not run away. They did not stop eating the barley. They just stared at me and went back to their supper, our barley. And we sat on the porch of that house, and we didn't know what to do. Finally, I said, I will go north to San Francisco. I will learn English, and I will return to the stage as Jessica. My husband would stay in Anaheim to try to sell the farm. The others would go to different places to try to make a living, but I would raise money to keep the community going. So I headed north, and for months I studied that horrible language, English. In San Francisco, I studied with everybody I could find. It is a terrible language. It tore my throat to shreds. I was living with the Polish community in a house on Otero. So the young Polish woman, Jo, was my teacher. She said, the accent is fine. It makes you unique. You don't need to completely destroy your accent, but you must not say da. You must say da. You must lisp the th, da, not da, da, da. If you can just do the little lisp, you will be fine. Your accent will make you unique. So I thought, da, da, da. Unfortunately, I was running short of money. So I took Joe with me. We dressed up very fine and we went down to the California Theater to see the manager, where we had seen Edwin Booth. And I asked him for an audition. He said he could not see me. For the next 2 weeks, the stage was booked. Mornings, afternoons, evenings, there was no time to see me. So Joe and I waited 2 weeks, and then we went back to the California Theater to see the manager. He said, unfortunately, the stage is booked for another week, morning, afternoon, evening. I cannot see you. We waited another week, and Joe and I went back to the theater, and he would not see us. It made sense. He didn't know who I was. He thought I was some society lady, an amateur. I had no notices to show him, no way to prove that I was Modjeska, the great actress from Poland. I was in despair. I told Joe I wanted to go to Oakland on the ferry to see Oakland. She did not believe me. She knew that once the ferry was in the middle of the bay, that I would disappear. She told me to not despair, that there was a Polish general, Krzyzanowski, who had fought in the Civil War, a Polish general fighting for the North. He had been at the Battle of Gettysburg. He would appeal to the theater manager that had given me an audition. But don't despair. I said, I won't despair, but I want to go to the cliffs and look at the sea lions. She said, why? And I said, because I like sea lions and I want to hear them bark. And she was concerned. I said, I will not go in the water at once. I just want to look at the sea lions. I went to the cliffs and I stared up at sea, at the sea lions. And they barked. And I thought, they should be on stage. They had such wonderful projection. I wish I was a sea lion. I walked home, full of despair. And at home I was told that the general had talked to the theater manager, and that he would see me. He would see me on Tuesday. The stage was available. He had been prevailed upon. So on Tuesday, Joe and I went down to the theater. And we met the theater manager. And he said, unfortunately, the stage is booked. I cannot see you. I stood there. I did not leave. I left too many times before. I nearly smiled. He said, oh, there is a studio. You can come up to the studio and you can audition in the studio. So we trudged to the top of this massive theater, and at the top in the attic, which had a rounded roof and no windows, was a tiny stage, 15 feet wide. He said, you may audition on that stage. He took a chair and sat opposite the stage and sat in it like it was a throne. And he said to me, I must warn you, I will be critical. If you are an amateur, I will say that you are an amateur. I will not be kind. I nodded my head. I smiled. I saw that he was wearing a handkerchief in his jacket pocket. And I knew what I must do from the moment I saw that handkerchief. Joe and I had prepared to do work from Adrienne. Joe would play all the other parts. For my audition, I would play Adrienne. And we would present for my audition the entire final act of Adrienne. Look, good Lord. The whole act. And at the end of the act, I was given flowers for my lover Maurice, roses, and I pressed them to my face and sniffed them. And my lungs were full of poison. And I realized that the flowers had been the poison. And Maurice walked in the room, and I threw the flowers down at his feet. And I fell against the wall. And I said, Maurice, your flowers? He said, those are not my flowers. They were given to you by your rival, the other actress. She is jealous of you. And I slumped down onto the ground. And Maurice ran to me. And he held me. And he put his hand on my cheek. And at that moment, out of the corner of my eye, I saw the manager. I saw him very slowly remove the handkerchief from his pocket and dab his eye. Boris, it is only important that you are here now. And I
expire.
Manager rose from his chair. He walked toward me, he put out his hand. I took his hand and rose up. I looked into his face and there were tear drops down his cheeks. And I said, could I have a single night with your company to perform at the end? He said, a single night? You shall have 2 weeks. My friends prevailed upon me to take a room in the Palace Hotel on Market Street. I lived there. My husband came and stayed with me. And it was a magnificent 2 weeks of Adrian at the California Theater, and I became the toast of San Francisco. Majesta! Now, it was prevailed upon me also to go to New York. I must have a New York opening, but there were no theaters available until December or January. So another producer came to me and said, won't you be so kind as to come to Virginia City to entertain the miners, the silver miners? So I embarked on a Wild West tour to entertain the miners. Now, I was very nervous because I never performed for an audience of all men. I thought these are Wild West men. They will shoot the place up with their pistols and their revolvers. I read about this in books. And that first night, I would perform a new role for me, Camille, Marguerite Gautier in Camille. But I thought the audience will only like the violence, the fighting, the lovemaking. They will not like my speeches. They will be bored. They will shoot their guns off. I was so nervous. I stand behind the curtain. It shot up, the lights came on, and in front of me were 100 well-dressed men, with ties and coats, their hats in their laps, smiling. They were a wonderful audience, desperate for entertainment, and so appreciative of everything. And at the end of the play, Marguerite Gautier has consumption, she's dying. Of consumption in her bed. The man she loves on board comes to see her. She has lost him, but he comes to her deathbed. And she says to him, Arnabal, it is not so hard to die. And then she sighed. A hush fell over the audience of miners, and then they cheered. And I loved my Wild West tour so much that I said to the producer that I wanted to see the mines. They had seen them do my work. I wanted to see them do their work. But he said, you cannot go into the mines. They are miners. No women are allowed. I said, ah, but I am a master of disguise. I will disguise myself as a man, and then you can take me down into the mines. So, once again, I prepared myself to disguise. And I put on my mustache. And we descended on this long elevator into the mines. It was magnificent. This elevator took us down and blew up my chest. I put my hands in my belt and I stood like a man. But as we went lower and lower, it became hotter and hotter. It was sweltering down there, stifling. And when we arrived, he threw the gate of the elevator back. And I was surrounded by almost completely naked men, covered in sweat. It was astonishing. I'd never seen anything like this. And they were drilling with their muscles, drilling, and hammering, and pulling, and their bodies were covered with sweat. Sweat was everywhere on naked bodies, and they were drill, pick, and drill, and pick. sick, and all, I was surrounded by sweat and bodies, and I became overwhelmed. I kept thinking, I wish my husband was here, and my husband, I need him desperately. When I get above ground, I will meet my husband more than I've ever needed him before. And I was surrounded by these men, and I was becoming more and more. And they were more and more. And finally I said to my producer, we must ascend. I am overwhelmed. We ascended again. The air cooled. I ran to the telegraph office and I said to my husband, please join me quickly in Virginia City. It was a magnificent time going down the mines and entertaining the miners. And my tour continued. I played many places in the mining country, and I always loved the audiences. I returned to San Francisco, and I was told that I should tour some of the cities around San Francisco. So I gave a performance in what I was told was a very cultured place. It was called San Jose. And I was told they had a very cultured audience there who would turn out to see me and be very grateful for my performance. So I would perform the Camilla. I was very excited. I always liked cultured audiences and always thought, these are the people that I live for. These are the people that I love to perform for, the cultured audiences. So I was dressed as Camilla. I was standing behind the curtain. The curtain flew up in San Jose. The lights hit me in the face and I looked out into the audience to see 30 people. The entire cultured populace of San Jose, this very big city. I thought, well, they pay. They deserve, nevertheless, to see Majeska. Afterwards, the producer in San Jose was very embarrassed. He came backstage and said, I cannot pay you. There are only 30 people, but I will give you my ring and my watch. I said, keep your ring and your watch. I loved to perform. I loved to perform for everybody of culture in San Jose. I was sent to New York. It was time to make my New York debut. Now, at that time, the stars always directed their own productions. They played the leading role and they directed all the other actors. But the New York producer was concerned about my English. He said it might be very hard for me to communicate with the New York actors. They barely understood English themselves. And if it was accented, I would be lost. So I was assigned a director, a very talented man named Dion Boucicault. He was magnificent with the actors. Every detail, he supported me and made the scenery, the mise-en-scène, the other performances magical. I was so enamored of him that I went to see him perform one of his plays. He wrote his own plays, he directed them, he starred in them, and he produced them. The Octoroon was his production. It was magnificent. One man, the attention to detail, everything about the production he had looked at and made perfect. I was so impressed with Mr. Boucicault. He was a great inspiration to me. For my performances at the end, I was given a man named Burroughs to play my Maurice, my lover. And when I met him, he seemed a little light. It was hard to believe the audience would accept him as my brusque, big lover. But on opening night, he arrived with all this padding and he talked like this. And he became my lover and he grabbed me and held me and kissed me on the lips. I thought, my goodness, this is acting. The transformation of this light little man into this big brusque lover. Some people are born for the stage and depiction.
I only made one mistake in my premiere as Adrienne in New York. I was supposed to enter in the second act with my fan, and mistakenly I entered not holding my fan, but a hanger. I did not realize that I made this mistake until I started fanning myself with the hanger. I saw that I was fanning myself with a hanger. I just continued to fan myself with a hanger. The audience thought it was brilliant. What a bold decision to fan myself with a hanger. And I gestured, and I exited, and I used the hanger throughout the act. Now, the critics were very kind to me in New York. I'd been so nervous, but the reviewers were magnificent. But they were a little bit confused by my son. They thought, is she the right age to play this role? She has a son who's 16. Isn't she too old? But my producer handled it. He said, no, that's not her son, it's her brother. Problem solved. I went on a national tour. I toured the United States. I was so excited about this tour because I was going to be able to see the country. I went to St. Louis, to Chicago, to Boston. I traveled about everywhere, giving my performances as Adrienne, Marguerite Gautier, Juliet, and Ophelia. And in Washington, D.C., I met a magnificent man, the former President General Grant, Ulysses S. Grant. He was so much bigger than I ever expected. And when he entered the room, there was such an aura of magnificence about him that everybody became silent. I was going back to Europe on a tour, and I would return to Poland, and I would give a performance in Warsaw. I was back in my own home country, and I didn't think I could remember my lines as Adrienne in Polish. I'd been performing in English only for so long, and I was backstage once again, terrified, but my husband helped me to the curtain, and the curtain soared up, and lights shined on me, and I remembered every word of Polish. Afterwards, a line of small children greeted me, 12 of them, and they presented me with little flowers wrapped in ribbon the color of the Polish national flag. The police came and grabbed all those flowers, threw them away, and they took the children with them. The children, they said, were trying to incite a riot, an insurrection with this nationalist trash. I said, they're flowers, those are ribbons. They said, no, this is an act of insurrection. I said, they're children. Their punishment, they were not allowed to go to school. They were banned from all schools by the Russians. One of the little boys killed himself. He was so distraught. And I thought, my poor country, belonging to no one, belonging to everyone, and now destroying its own children. On my way home, I visited Paris. I was taken to see Sarah Bernhardt. She was otherworldly. I'd never seen anybody on stage who could command the stage like she could, but she seemed also so natural, like she belonged there, like she lived in the play. I had never seen anything so authentic as Sarah Bernhardt. Inspired by her performance, I returned to New York, and at the party in New York, I met Walt Whitman with all of his whiskers and his hat. He didn't look like he lived in a house or an apartment. He looked like he lived in the woods or in the park or on the streets of New York. He was biblical. He was majestic. And his poetry was my introduction to American. And I realized from this bard of Brooklyn that the Americans had a language of their own, a drama of their own, a poetry, a sensibility unique to themselves.
I went to London. I was to make my debut in London, West End. I saw my name on placards, on billboards. Majeska, Majeska. But nobody knew who I was. They did not know that I was Majeska. They just saw this strange name. And I overheard people asking, what is Majeska? Is it a hair tonic? Is it a sanitary cereal? Sanitary cereal? I was not a sanitary cereal, but nobody knew who I was. They also knew nothing about Poland. They thought that Poland was merely a part of Russia. My debut was magnificent. I was nervous as always, but when the curtain rose up, I lived in the performance. The audience was so appreciative. I was taken to a performance of Henry Irving in Shylock. He was magnificent. The actor again, like Bernhardt, who lived on stage. I also saw Ellen Terry, the wonderful English actress. And one night, Sarah Bernhardt came to see me as Marguerite Gautier in Camille. I couldn't believe she was in the audience. And when she came backstage, there were tears in her eyes. And she was so small, a little wisp of a woman. I realized that on stage, she filled the stage with nothing. She inhabited space much bigger than ever she could inhabit it normally when she was on stage. She was just tiny thing. I realized that I was in the presence of the greatest actress of all time and the kindest woman. To cry at my Marguerite de Coutier. There are many more successes, but success is in a way disappointing. But there was no more political intrigue or censorship, no jealousy. Everybody I worked with was magnificent. I had found my home, America. And it all started in San Francisco at the California Theater. And one of the great performances I gave in America was as Nora in Doll's House. I gave the American premiere of that production. And I felt such an affinity for the character. Because Nora had learned the lesson that I had learned, never to let a husband or a country or anyone take me for granted or treat me as something other than an equal. Eventually, I retired with my wonderful husband. My son Rudolf did become an engineer, a wonderful engineer. And one day he sang to me that song that my aunt had sung at the window. And it was Swanee, Swanee River. How had my aunt known that? And this, of course, was important to my son because he bridged rivers, he bridged bays. He eventually built the Bay Bridge from San Francisco to Oakland. My son, Rudolf. And my husband and I retired to Anaheim, to what at that time was called Orange County, because the oranges grew magically. And I realized that Orange County was a place not for the poor people, but for rich people like my husband and I. We built a wonderful house, and I named our property after the Arden Forest from As You Like It, one of my favorite Shakespeare plays. Thank you, America. Thank you, San Francisco. Thank you to my audience. My name is John Fisher, and this has been Majeska. Thank you for joining me this evening on Zoom and Facebook Live.
As you know, we've been presenting shows all summer long. We just had a show on Tuesday. I'll have another show on Thursday, so tune back in. And we'll be bringing more theater to you during these COVID-19 times, presenting new works of live theater on Zoom at Facebook Live. If you'd like to support these performances, you can do so on our website. And I think I might even have the ability to share the screen. Yes, this is the first time I've ever done this. Share screen. And there it is. Our website, www.therhino.org. Or you can mail it to that address. That's my home address where I'm sheltering in place. But thank you so much for being with me tonight. But Jessica's always meant so much to me. And she didn't leave a trace. I mean, it's no movies or sound. But her story is so magical. And to read her autobiography, it's priceless. It really is one of the great books about theater. So thank you so much for being with me tonight. I'm John Fisher. Be safe. Be well. Good night.